Praise the Lord, saints. My name is Pastor Deborah Tate, and I'm with Royal Diadem Internet Ministry, and we are the Crown Gem of Cleveland, Ohio, bringing to you the very best in gospel music. I want to thank you for clicking in and joining me for a time of encouraging words. The time of encouraging words comes on every Sunday morning from 12 o'clock a.m. to 12:30 a.m. And we are the Crown Gem of Cleveland, Ohio, and we come on live365.com station, the Crown Gem. And we're going to be talking about mentoring for life change. That's what we've been talking about all week. We started out in 2 Timothy 3rd chapter 1 through 7, where Paul is mentoring Timotheus, and he's telling Timothy that one of the signs of the last days, he said it's going to be perilous times, but he starts talking about the disposition of mankind, how men will be self-centered and full of bitterness and full of hate. And then he starts talking about silly women, and he's telling Paul, he says, he's trying to teach Paul how to protect his ministry, and he's trying to teach Paul how to watch out, like the mothers used to tell me, for the hooks in the pond. Now that, to me, is an encouraging word. But we come on every Sunday from 12 o'clock to 12:30 a.m., and then we're on rotation. And that's on live365.com, station the Crown Gem. And if you like the transcript, you can find this transcript at www.royaldiademministries.ning.com. Let's go to the throne room of grace to receive mercy from our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Father, we come before you right now in the mighty and majestic name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. We thank you for another time of encouraging words. We thank you for wisdom. We thank you for revelation. And we thank you for knowledge. And Lord, we're asking that you open our eyes to see the suffering of others. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. Again, praise the Lord, saints. My name is Pastor Deborah Tate. I'm with Royal Diadem Internet Ministry, and I want to thank you for clicking in and joining me for a time of encouraging words. We do come on from 12 o'clock to 12:30 a.m. that Sunday morning, and if you can't sleep, this is a good time to open up your Bible and join me for a time of encouraging words. I also have another program in the morning time called A Morning Cup of Word, and I come on from 6 o'clock to 8 o'clock a.m., and that's Eastern time. Okay, that's East Coast time. That's Eastern time. So you can a time of encouraging word. I pretty much give you a summary of what we're going to be talking about all week. And for the last couple of days, we've been coming out of 2 Timothy 3rd chapter 1 through 7. We've been talking about one of the signs of the last days is that the way people will be treating one another, like what we've been seeing with the Sandy Hook shootings and the Colorado theater shooting, and then here recently the Naval Yard shooting. These are perilous times, and the Bible tells us this. And one of the signs of the end times is how mean people will be to one another. These are and the Bible says perilous times. And our trivial question is this: who did not like Jesus eating with tax collectors? Who did not like Jesus eating with tax collectors and sinners? And the answer is the religious leaders, the scribes and the Pharisees. And you can find that portion of scripture in Luke chapter 15, verse 2, coming out of the King James Version. Now, our faith without works is dead meditation is this. Keep your eyes on the Lord. He never takes his eyes off of you. The rock of ages stands secure. He always will be there. He watches over all his own to claim their, to calm their anxious care. And that's by Keith. Let me read that again. Faith without works is dead meditation. Keep your eyes on the Lord. That's your works. That shows your faith. It's by keeping your eyes on the Lord. He never takes his eyes off of you. The rock of ages stands secure. He always will be there. He watches over all his own to calm their anxious care. Now, to me, that is an encouraging word. We've been talking about mentorship all this past week, and I want to just share with you what we've been talking about and what we're going to be talking about all next week. And then October the 1st, I do this series every year. It's called It's a Trick and You're the Treat. And I want to show you how the enemy tries to trick us into sinning, into compromising the word of God so that he can eat, he can treat. And the word treat also means he can be amused by our suffering or be a form of entertainment. We can become a form of entertainment when he gets us to do that which the word of God tells us we're not to do. Okay, and I'm going to talk about that with you in details. So next week, we're going to be talking about where the week after October the 1st, I start my series for the whole month of October. It's a trick and you're the treat. And I'm going to walk you through story about Saul going to the witch of Endor. I'm going to share with you the Garden of Eden, where the first trick was done, and where we became the dust eater, or where he became the dust eater and we became the dust that the enemy eats. I'm going to be talking about all of that. And I want you to be able to see the word of God and be able to apply it in your life in Jesus' name. But we've been talking about mentor, and I told you that a mentor is an experienced and trusted advisor. A mentor is also a person who will give you good information. Now, a mentor or mentoring is a verb, and it's a type of an action. And it's an action where you have the ability to train someone who is younger and least experienced or less experienced than you. I told you that a mentor is also a person, a friend, who guides a less experienced person by building up trust. You've got to build up trust in a person. A mentor is also a person who will give you good information. A mentor is a person that becomes your friend. He builds up your trust. He models, or she models, a good behavior in front of you. She or he sets forth a good example, teaching the mentee good work, good ethics, how to be honest, how to be truthful. Second, I told you that a mentor is a person who becomes a friend to their mentee by building up a relationship that is authentic and by staying in tune to the needs of the mentee. This is what makes a good mentor. I told you that a mentor can be a critical ingredient towards positive youth outcome. The word mentor also comes from the Homer epic tale called the Odyssey. And this is where a young man, a young father, goes out to sea, goes out to war, and his son is left alone. And Homer mentors the young boy whose father is out at sea or out at war. and that's Homer's epic tale called The Odyssey. I also told you that it's not good for any Christian to try to be a solo or be solo in this journey. Christian ministry was never meant to be a solo journey. And we're seeing people are now separating themselves from the organized church because of some of the ungodly behavior that we see that's going on in the church. And I believe this is why God called me forth into the internet ministry, to let you know that you're not alone, that there is somebody that will pray with you, okay, and intercede with you, laugh with you, and cry with you. And internet is kind of like safe. You don't have to worry about, me hurting you. It's safe until you're able to emotionally and psychologically return. And that's the purpose and goal, is for you to return to regular worship. We know that the church should be a place of Holy Ghost-filled, godly mentoring. And this is what our children need. And when they see us falling short, it makes them not want to come to church, because they're saying, well, it didn't work for you. You know, look at you, look at your life. You know, then, you know, this isn't real. This is just a philosophy. This is just a doctrine. But it is through godly living that we show the power of God. The power of God is not being slain out in the spirit. The power of God is not the miracles, although that's part of it. But if you really want to know what's the best miracle of all, it's the saving of a soul. It's when there is true conversion, where there's true repentance, and that person is bearing fruits of righteousness, where their life is totally changed. And the change is obvious. They just don't do the things they used to do. Other than that, miracles are fine. But the Bible even shows us that even Satan's able to perform miracles. Prophecy is fine. But the Bible shows us that Satan has people that can prophesy and be accurate. But what they cannot do, what is hard for them to do, what seems to be impossible for them to do, is to walk with God, to live holy. That seems to be the hardest part. And this is how you judge and you discern whether or not a person is true. It's how they live their life once they have made that commitment. Now, we all fell short of His glory. I know before I got saved, it was a struggle for a season in my life. But as you keep practicing the presence of the Lord, and as you keep practicing this walk, you get stronger in it. Now, if I'm still doing the same things I was doing 20 years ago, then my salvation wasn't sincere. It wasn't real. Because true change means that everything that I used to do in the past, I no longer do. That's true change. The way I treat people is different. The way I talk to people is different. The way I live my life is different. That person that I used to be is no longer there. That is true salvation. And a mentor has to be a person that's had a real encounter with the Lord Jesus Christ, and that there is visible signs of a changed life. Not somebody that gets in a pulpit and then turns around and gets out here and gets everybody pregnant, cheats on their wife or cheats on their husband. You can't have that. There has to be a true change. Once that true change comes, then God will elevate your ministry. A lot of ministries are held back because that change is in there, and God sees it, and He can't allow you to hurt the body of Christ, because the body of Christ is already hurting as it is. So God has to wait till there's a maturity, and He helps us mature by sending people into our lives to be fathers and to be mothers to us. Maybe we didn't have a father. Maybe we didn't have a mother for whatever reason. God will send people into your life to mother you and to father you and to help you get where you need to be in order for him to be able to raise you up. I also gave scriptures about how it is important to have godly mentors and how it's important not to separate oneself from the church. I also told the listener last week why God had called me into the internet ministry to reach those that had been emotionally and psychologically hurt from God's people. And that is why a lot of people don't go to church and why there is a very strong falling away. Hopefully we're going to pray and believe God that that will stop. In Hebrews chapter 10, verse 25, coming out of the King James Version, the word of God says this: not forsaking the assembling of ourselves together as the manner of some is, but exhorting one another, so much the more as ye see the day approaching. The word exhorting means to spur on or encourage, especially by cheers and by shouts. And I told you, I said that if we were to spur each other on, if we were to encourage each other, if we would encourage each other with cheers and with shouts and give honor to where honor is due, I think we would see people bringing more people to church. Now, to me, that is an encouraging word. I came out of Proverbs chapter 11, verse 14, coming out of the NIV. I also posted several different translations, and there's a reason for that. Let's look at the NIV, the New International Version translation of Proverbs chapter 11, 14. And it's telling us the importance of having godly advisors, godly counseling. The Bible says that the lack of guidance, a nation falls, but victory is won through many advisors. So the lack of guidance, the lack of godly guidance, is only a matter of time that a nation will fall. Victory is won through many advisors. In Proverbs chapter 11, verse 14, coming out of the New Living Version, the Bible says this in this translation: without wise leadership, a nation falls. There is safety in having many advisors. So we learn that in the King James Version of Proverbs 11, 14, the Bible says the lack of guidance, a nation falls. The New Living Version says without wise leadership, a nation falls. And we know that we should pray for our leaders, because when we pray for our leaders, God gives them the wisdom, the revelation, and the knowledge that they need. I don't care if it is Obama or who it is. We all fall short of his glory. No matter who's in the White House, we all fall short of his glory. We should pray for them, that God will intervene, that God will touch their hearts, that God will reach them where no man can reach them. And that God will guide them to do that which is right for this country as a whole. In Proverbs 11, verse 14, coming out of the English Standard Version, the Word of God says, where there is no guidance, a people falls. But in an abundance of counsel, there is safety. Even as children, if children grow up with no guidance, they will fall. They will fall. So it's important as the church that we give them guidance. Proverbs chapter 11, verse 14, coming out of the New American Standard Bible, the Word of God says this: where there is no guidance, the people fall, but in abundance of counselors, there is victory, especially the counseling of the godly. Now let's look at some cross references while we still have time. In 2 Chronicles, the 22nd chapter, the 4th verse coming out of the King James Version, the Word of God says this: He did evil in the eyes of the Lord as the house of Ahab had done. Now, let's look at the word house, because I want you to understand this. The word house can mean a structure in which you live in, or you pay rent or a mortgage to. A house can also mean your family, your grandparents, your mother and father, your sisters and brothers, your sibling, your nephews, your aunts, your uncles. But a house also means a nation. He did evil in the eyes of the Lord as the house of Ahab had done. For after his father's death, they became his advisors to his undoing. And we know about Ahab and Jezebel. Now let's go to a Proverbs chapter 15, verse 22. Plans fail for lack of counsel, but with many advisor, they succeed. You need mentorship. You need people guiding you. Proverbs chapter 24, verse 6, coming out of the King James Version. Surely you need guidance to wage war, and victory is won through many advisors. Remember, we thought we was getting ready to go to war to Syria. And one thing I do commend President Obama about is that he went to Congress, because you need guidance to wage war, and victory is won through many advisors. That's why they voted on it. Proverbs chapter 20, verse 18, coming out of the King James Version. Plans are established by seeking advice. So if your wage was obtained, guidance. I think I wrote that right. I hope I wrote that right. And we also talked about Moses. Moses was a mentor for Joshua. He was Joshua's mentor, because it would be Joshua who would take over and take Israel into Kadesh Barnea, into Canaan. And a good mentor is a person that's going to pray and intercede for you and birth your ministry. Okay? And we see here that Moses has his arms up. He has Aaron. If you have your Bible, go to Exodus chapter 17, verses 10 and 12. And you'll see it says this: So Joshua fought the Amalekites as Moses had ordered. And Moses and Aaron and went to the top of the hill. And as long as Moses held up his hands, the Israelites were winning. That's what a mentor has to do. He or she has to hold her hands up and do spiritual warfare for you. Pray for you. The Israelites were winning, but whenever he lowered his hands, the Amalekites were winning. When Moses' hands grew tired, they took a stone and put it under him, and he sat on it. Aaron and held his hands up, one on one side, one on the other, so that his hands remained steady till sunset. That's Exodus chapter 17. But what I'm seeing, and I have to agree with the person that wrote this statement, his name is Gordon McDonald. Never before have I been more convinced that adult Christians need to form personal friendships with those who share our commitment and values. Why mentoring? Because we need regular contact with a friend, someone who'll keep us close to Jesus, we have to answer to, that will continue to call us to faithfulness in Christ Jesus. Mentoring in business. In order to run a good business, in order to run a good ministry, you have to be a good businessman or woman. And a mentor can help the protege climb the ladder. The older and more experienced mentor can help clear the way, smooth the bumps. Trust and guide who helps others. Mentoring is all throughout the Bible. If all you had was 2 Timothy, the first chapter 1-8, what insights would you have for mentoring? While we still got time, Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus by the will of God, accordingly to the promise of life that is in Christ Jesus. To Timothy, my dear son, grace, mercy, and peace from God the Father and Christ Jesus our Lord. I thank God whom I serve as my forefathers did. With a clear conscience, as night and day, I constantly remember you in my prayers, recalling your tears. I long to see you so that I may be filled with joy. We see that Paul prayed for Timotheus. He prayed for him. And the best thing you can do as a mentor is to be an intercession and be an intercession. And right now, maybe you don't have a mentor. Maybe you don't have anybody in your life to encourage you. We're going to pray. And if you don't know Jesus, we're going to pray about that too. And all you have to say is, Lord, I admit that I'm a sinner and that I'm in need of a Savior. That's all you have to say. Please come into my heart. Please fill me with your precious Holy Spirit. And Father, I need a good church. I need a mentor. I need someone that's going to guide me and help me and teach me how to walk with you in Jesus' name. And if you said that, I want you to contact me at the Crown Gym at hotmail.com. And I also want you to write in my comment box, Pastor Tate, I have accepted Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, and I'm going to tell you why. Because the Word of God lets us know that if we confess with our mouths and believe in our hearts that God raised Jesus from the grave, it's not that we shall might, but we will be saved. And that comes out of Romans chapter 10, 9-10. And that's what we've been talking about. We've been talking about mentoring. And I've been your host. My name is Pastor Deborah Tate. You've been listening to A Time of Encouraging Words here on Live365.com station, The Crown Gem. And we have a lot of great music and independent artists and artists from label companies that you can listen to on Live365.com, The Crown Gem. And also I come on every morning from 7 o'clock to 8 o'clock a.m. on Live365.com station, The Crown Gem, for our morning cup of word. And there I go into more details about mentoring. And in October the 1st, we're going to be talking about Halloween, that holiday called Halloween, and why a Christian should not participate in that type of celebration. All right. I've been your host. My name is Pastor Deborah Tate. Thank you for joining me for A Time of Encouraging Word here on Live365.com station, The Crown Gem. And remember Isaiah chapter 62, verse 3, thou shalt be a crown of glory in the hand of the Lord, and a royal diadem in the hand of thy God. And I've been your host, and thank you for joining me. Selah.